good morning. Not bad, not bad. All right. Glad to have you guys all out this morning, and those that are online just now getting tuned in, we're glad to have you guys on there. Happy Father's Day to all our dads in the house and online. Yeah, give them a hand. Give them a hand. It's a tough job, tough duty, but very rewarding duty.
There is some tough duty with it.
There is some tough duty with it, yeah. We won't go there, though. We want this to be a very upbeat service, though. All right, so if you're here today, and it's been a long time since you've been here, you can see the little baskets at the end of the aisle there, and you can fill out a card. If you got a prayer request of some type that you have some type of a need, you can list that down. Put those in when the offering plate comes around here in a little bit. If this is the first time you've been here, then please definitely fill one out so we'll have a record of your attendance, then we can reach out to you. And we're going to have good service today. I figure we're going to have some good drumming. Is that correct? All right, bass, you're going to do your thing. Is that right, Michaela? Keyboard, are you ready? Piano, ready? Singers, guitar player, ready? Here we go. Put them on the spot. This is going to be good. So let's pray, and then we're going to get going. Lord, thank you that we have this day. Lord, thank you that we have this opportunity to be able to be together. Lord, thank you that we can be friends and be in one accord, worshiping you together. Lord, I pray that you would bless today. Lord, I pray that you'd bless and make it a special Father's Day today. Lord, I pray that you just bless each person here. Lord, we think of those that might be on the way. Lord, I pray that you bring them on in. I pray that our hearts would just be open, that we'd be blessed. Lord, thank you for this opportunity. Now, bless through the music, bless through the word, and just thank you for the freedom that we had to be able to worship. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. On this Father's Day, we are live from Revive.
All right. Thank you, John. If you guys would stand up with us, we are going to shout it from the rooftops today that we are not ashamed of Jesus and the gospel that saves us. Are loud or my ears are ringing, you're just not singing. I'm not ashamed of the one who saved my soul. I hear Angela. Not ashamed of the one who saved my soul. Now and then we just got to do something to get your blood going and let Jason worship with drums. All right, so this one's going to take us back a few years. It's been a long time since we've done this. A little bit older song, but great message. Every day we have 10,000 reasons that we can worship God. Saw a little guy yesterday with a shirt that says every day is a good day. And I was like, man, you know what? At first I said, that's optimistic. But then I was like, you know what? Yeah, a lot of times it's a choice of where we put our minds as to whether it's a good day or a bad day. It's what we choose to focus on. As this song says, it's what we choose to find that we can worship God for. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, oh my soul. Worship His holy name and sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. Time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Thank you. creation suddenly articulates with a thousand tongues to lift one cry from north to south and east to west. We dear Christ be be magnified. Man, good singing this morning. You guys can have a seat. So happy Father's Day, as John said a little earlier. We're going to do something a little different this morning. For Mother's Day, we had a poem. For Father's Day, we have a song. About 2 or 3 weeks ago, we were heading back from SeaWorld at the tail end of my mission to Croatia, which I'm going to share with you guys about in a little bit. We had to quarantine for a little while, and so we had some time away and some good family time and reconnecting. And then we took some vacation on the backside of that and went to SeaWorld. And on the way back, stuck in the wonderful I-4 traffic for way too long, this melody started just going through my head over and over and over again. And I thought about kind of where we are in life and having a kid graduate and Father's Day coming up and all that stuff. And so took advantage of the downtime and the traffic to just sing this over and over in my head until I could kind of solidify it and get home, get to the piano, and start working it out. And so this is a song that I'm going to try to get through from me to my girls, because I love being your dad. But also my hope is that this will just be an encouraging word to parents. It's definitely from a dad's point of view. This is like dad advice. You know, we got on to John not too long ago for dad jokes. This is like dad advice, the things that dads want to say to their kids. But my hope is that it'll just be an encouraging message from parents to kids as well, and that this would be something that you guys, that would be meaningful to you guys. It's 3 a.m. again, and sometimes I think this kid will never sleep, so I'll hold her tight and sing another song, 'cause I know these moments won't last long. And while I sing, I pray that the monsters of this world will stay away. I know I'm not ready for today. She just grabbed the keys and drove the car away. She'll be right back, it won't be gone too long, but I won't breathe the whole time anyway. And while she's gone, this world will stay away. But keep on pushing, keep on fighting, let the hard days make you stronger. Keep on dancing, keep on singing, till your wounded heart grows wings. Keep on dreaming, keep on praying, take his hand and he will guide you. And no matter what tomorrow, don't give in. I know you are ready for today. You have learned so much and grown in so many ways. And I can't hold to what we had before, 'cause I know that you're a gift for this whole world. And while you go, I pray the temptations of this world will stay away. But keep on pushing, keep on fighting, let the hard days make you stronger. Keep on dancing, keep on singing, till your wounded heart grows wings. Keep on dreaming, keep on praying, take his hand and he will guide you. And no matter what tomorrow throws it you? Don't give in when the world is crashing in. Don't give in when your heart is torn in two. For you are stronger than you know. You are braver than you feel. And no matter where you are, we're always near. But keep on pushing, keep on fighting. Let the hard days make you stronger. Keep on dancing, keep on singing, till your wounded heart grows wings. Keep on dreaming, keep on praying. Take his hand and he will guide you. And no matter what tomorrow throws at you, don't give in. Don't.
Very nice, very nice, very nice. All right. Let's do a few announcements. We've got the young people back there going to take up the offering here in just a few minutes. Church mission statement: share new life in Jesus and develop Christ followers who change the world. So that's our mission statement. We offer services at 8 o'clock each Sunday morning. You can come to the traditional service or the 10:30 service that you're in today. Or we've got our grow groups, which we call Sunday school, or which we call grow groups at Sunday school. That's at 9:15. You can call them what you want. 9:15, it's a good time. You can learn and get some good fellowship in and just get to know folks. Wednesday night, youth meet at 6:30. Very good. Midweek service, 7 o'clock. The kids, the Kingdom Kids Wednesday night. I see that posted and that there's been kids there. Looks like they were eating well, having a good time, playing games. That's Wednesday night at 5 o'clock, and that goes till about 8 o'clock. They do have a Bible study time. And, of course, that will that's like children's church-age kids, elementary-type age kids. And that will lead into the camp, the Kingdom Kids Camp, which will be July 11th through the 14th. And we've got several that are volunteering for that. We do need more chaperones. But if you know kids in that age range, encourage them to come Wednesday night so they can get involved in that, get comfortable, and then they can be here for the camp. That'll be real, real nice. And I'm sure that they will learn a lot and have a good time. Got lots of youth things still happening. We've still got the youth fundraiser out there in the hall with the yellow sticky notes. There still are some small ones, you know, for like $7, $4, $9, things like that. If you can grab one of those, peel it off, and then put that in the offering plate the next time you're here, that'd be great. That'll help our youth getting to camp. And then two things happening on the 26th. So mark this on your calendar, June 26th. From 9 to 12, there's going to be a youth car wash. Have you determined a location?
I've got to check with Harvest Meat Market. That's my last.
Okay. Okay, so it'll either be at Harvest Meat Market or here at the church. So if you go to Harvest and you get out of your car and nobody starts cleaning your car, come on down to the church. That's what we call a clue. All right. And then also on that day, there's a work day here at the church. If you'd like to work, 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 work. Now, you can have a good time. You can have some good fellowship, and I think it's going to be working inside here, painting in the auditorium area here. So be sure to come to that on June 26th. That's a Saturday, same day. You can get your car cleaned up. You can come here, knock out a couple things. About 7 o'clock in the morning, 7 to 8 o'clock, if you can come and work, you know, for however long you can make it, and that way fix up the building here and do great things with that. Now, some of you guys, are you going to sing? You are? Excellent. Some of you guys are pretty good at observation, okay? So like today, I noticed a couple different things, okay? So I noticed during that pretty song there, and maybe this is just, I noticed Chris's earpieces, okay? Chris, do you have multiple earpieces because they match your shirt? That is crazy. That is good. Okay. All right. So anyway, he's color coordinated his earpieces with his shirt. That's very nice. And then I noticed he's got like an iPad over there or some type of little screen deal that that he puts the music on so that you're not flipping a book and all that. I noticed those. Now, so with our trained observers in the house here, what did you guys, what have you guys noticed different about me from when I got up and did the opening? Very good, very good. You did excellent. I was afraid somebody was going to say, yeah, you look older. Or your hair looks grayer, which would be almost an impossibility. Anyway, I did change shirts, and today being Father's Day, and then since the Holy Spirit evidently spoke to Russell and Melissa, and they saw this shirt out someplace and bought this for me, which was very nice. It's got the dad's joke. You know, when I started doing the dad jokes, I heard that the pastor had commented something about John's dad jokes or something. I was like, I didn't even know they called him dad jokes, so that was the first joke on me. But anyway, today's Father's Day. I looked up just a few dad jokes, so here we go. You know, in presenting dad jokes, the key is how you do it optimistically, and then timing is everything. So here's the first one. Being a father is like shaving. No matter how good you shave today, you have to do it again tomorrow. Excellent. All right, I got the drum involved here. All right, you just got to suffer through two more. Oh, and something I've decided based on what occurred today is the fact of next week I will be bringing vacation jokes. Do you get it? Anybody want to supply me with a vacation? And the week after that, I'll do car jokes in case somebody wants to give me a car. All right? No, I'll stick to dad jokes. Here we go. Dad joke number two. You'll never amount to anything because you procrastinate. That's the dad saying that. You procrastinate. Son, oh yeah? Just you wait. And the last one, which has totally everything to do with dad jokes, it says, there's a big difference between bad jokes and dad jokes. And the difference is the first letter. Thank you. Oh, no, stand by. Okay. So, yeah, we better pray for the offering because we're going to need some money put in based on that. So, Jordan has volunteered. Oh. Yes, for online. Okay, so this is Jordan. Jordan is going to sing, but Jordan has also volunteered to pray for our offering today. So we're very thankful for that. Miss Jordan.
Thanks for that. You guys can come on down.
Let's pray.
You guys can come down.
At least she's staying in charge, guys.
Okay, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this day, and thank you for letting us come here together and gather and celebrate you and our fathers today. I pray that we all have a good rest of our weekend and that we honor you in everything that we do, and we love you in Jesus' name, pray. Amen.
For me to know you.
All right. Kids can head out to Children's Church now if they haven't escaped already. Yeah, you guys have fun. Sugar them up so they're nice and hyper when they go home. Parents love that. Yes. All right. Well, it is that time again. So if you're new to us, I was not on a month-long vacation. I am a chaplain in the Florida Army National Guard. And I do spend a good bit of time doing ministry there. And we as a church see that as an extension of our ministry here. And so at least once a year, I try to share what God is doing there and what it is that I do so you know when I'm away what's going on and how you can be praying. I don't think I got to do this in 2020 with all the craziness that was going on. And so I'm going to kind of bridge the gap between last year and what's gone on this year. First, though, I'm going to show you just a quick video because there's just not enough time to show all the photos, talk about all the stuff. So I've got a quick video that I'm going to show you that'll be a summary, and then I'll dig into some of the technical things that I do as a chaplain, what my ministry looks like there, and then show you some pictures of the beautiful country of Croatia that I got to go to the end part of May. And then if we still have time before IBL needs to come in and take the room over for their worship service, then I'll take some questions if you guys have them. So Jake, if you will go right ahead, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. So close to 20 years ago, I sat in a presentation like this, and a Civil Air Patrol chaplain that was connected to our church came and was sharing about his ministry. And I was not even finished with Bible school yet, and God was stirring my heart towards this direction. And it was a long road and a lot of hard stuff to get there. But God eventually opened the door in his time. The exact same month that I came here to pastor, I was also commissioned as a chaplain. And God has worked through that ministry in a whole lot of ways. And that's why I try to share with you what's going on. Because there are things there that that are just opportunities to share about Christ and the hope that we have that I wouldn't have otherwise. You would think that pastors get all kinds of opportunities to talk to lost people, but the reality is, unless I work hard to make those things happen, I hang out with Christians all the time. And so the guard gives me that opportunity to not only be able to share my faith, but to hear the voices in the hearts of those who do not yet believe, to help keep me grounded in that mindset so that I can lead better here. So I want to start with, though, a little bit about what it means to be a chaplain, because there are a whole lot of misconceptions about it. I hear people ask things all the time, like, can I talk about Jesus, and can I pray in Jesus' name, and all of those kinds of things. So I want to try to address some of that so you understand what it is that I do there. And like I said earlier, so that you can be praying for me. Several years ago, I adopted this as my focus, my verse for my ministry there. It's Paul talking to the Corinthian church, and he's talking about Christians in general. He says, we are Christ's ambassadors. And in a whole lot of ways, that's what I see my role as there. I am an ambassador. I am an ambassador for Jesus. I am also an ambassador for our denomination. Every chaplain has to have a religious body behind them that endorses them. In other words, that says, this is a minister in good standing, trustworthy, went to school, all that kind of stuff. The government doesn't want to do that, which is wise, so they rely on religious organizations to do that. And so for me, through the North American Mission Board, which is the home mission board of the Southern Baptist Convention, I have that endorsement. So I represent you, I represent Southern Baptists, I represent our Lord and Savior as I'm there. I am an ambassador, and I love this next line. He says, as though God were making his appeal through us. So he's using us, he's using me to make his appeal, to implore people on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. That is my focus. When I am there in uniform, I want to represent God well so that I have the opportunity to tell someone about Jesus and see that life transformation take place, and Lord willing, see them confess him as Lord. For you, though, and for your benefit, I want you to know that there is a big picture that's involved in this that allows me to be there. And part of that is that there is not just Christian, there are not just Christian chaplains, but there are chaplains from several different backgrounds. Christian, Jewish, Muslim, Hindu, and Buddhist. And this is really what gives me the right to be there. This comes from the First Amendment to our Constitution, that the government is not going to establish or favor a religion, but the government is also not going to prohibit our free exercise of religion. It is in the middle of that that I have a job. I used to tell people that I was a pastor to soldiers, but it's really so much bigger than that. In a very real way, I am an ambassador for Christ, standing in the gap, making sure that every soldier, no matter what their faith background is, that every soldier has a right to worship as they choose. If you think about it, that's why we have an America. There's debate over that now and whatever, but I still know that there are people that came here. They made some mistakes, but they came here in search of a place where people could worship freely. And if we lose that, even if we lose it with good intentions because we want to put Christ forward, if we lose the culture of saying everyone can worship as they choose, if we lose that, then we lose the opportunity to be who we are. So by defending it for everyone, we defend it for ourselves. And one of the things I want you to understand is that there are organizations. One of them is called the Freedom From Religion Foundation. Freedom From Religion Foundation. There's an organization out there that is trying to prove that chaplains are unconstitutional and get us kicked out of the military. That's a point of prayer for you. The enemy, as I have told you so many times before, doesn't just lay down and give up because we're doing well. He doubles his efforts and he fights harder. So you have chaplains that have literally been in the military since the very beginning. You back up. Look at this on the crest. Okay, never mind. It's not going to show it now. But we've had chaplains serving in the military longer than we've had a nation. It's that vital to who we are. And some people want to take that away. But if we do our job and we do it well, and we protect the right for everyone to worship and to worship freely and to not feel oppressed, then we have the opportunity to also share Christ and the hope that we have in them. And that is what I am working towards. So then that's like the big view coming down a little bit. In the chaplain corps, we say that our mission is to care for the spiritual well-being of soldiers and their families. That's another unique thing that I get to do. This job that I do when I'm in uniform gives me an entryway into not only the soldier's life, but the family's life. You saw that in some of the pictures as we were doing weddings and as I have done funerals and I've done counseling. I'm able to touch those families as well, protecting all soldiers' freedom of religion. And then here is another key that we'll talk about in a minute, and that is I serve as an advisor to the commanders on issues of morale, ethics, and religion. I am the go-to guy when they have questions in those realms. Somebody asked in the last service if I have to study and be knowledgeable on all religions. No, I don't. They expect me to be a subject matter expert in my faith tradition. Obviously, I am. But also, I am expected to have the capacity to learn and to communicate what others believe so that I can advise my commander. And so I can advise them throughout the whole process. And then because of my role, because I am one of the ones that gets to move around the most, which you'll see in the pictures that I'll show you in a minute, I get to get a sense of the heartbeat or the pulse of our battalion because I see so many soldiers. So the commander relies on me to come back and to tell him or her what's going on in the field and what I am seeing and how people are doing. Reality is, though, most of my job is just hanging out with soldiers. I was amazed my first year or so as a chaplain. It felt really weird. It just kept going in the back of my mind, like, I'm just getting paid to hang out with people now. Like, that's really what the Army wants me to do. This is awesome. I started out as not an officer and not a chaplain. I was a supply specialist, and I was handing out supplies and taking inventories and setting things up and tearing things down and moving boxes from here to there to move other boxes from there to here and all of that stuff as a very young soldier. And suddenly the government set me free and gave me a paycheck to go hang out with soldiers, and it was awesome. And it still is. It is such a blessing because these men and women do amazing things. They give up time with their family. They give up sleep. They give up comfort. They give up safety to protect the things that we hold dear. And I get to be there and be a blessing and a minister to them. And one of the most amazing privileges that I've been given is on par with what I get to do here. And one of the things that I love about that is that I get to do that on your behalf. I tell my soldiers all the time that I am there representing a church of people that love them and pray for them and is available to them. And we've been able to make resources available to them through our church that have empowered that ministry. I'll share a little bit about that in a while too. But if you know anything about the military, you know that most of the time what they do is they train. And you saw in the video that this is what my guys do. We are the only howitzer-based field artillery battalion in the state of Florida. We are attached to an infantry brigade, and our guys are prepared day and night to provide fire support to the infantry as they do their ministry or their mission. And so the way I like to think of it is, if you like big things that go boom, it's a pretty cool job. They like to blow stuff up, and they are good at it, and it is fun to watch them do what they do. And this is part of why I love being with the battalion I'm with now. Each one of those weapons takes a crew of about six guys and or women. And it is so much fun to watch them work and train together and learn how to work together and set aside preferences and all of that. There's a lot that we can learn as church from how they do what they do. And most of what I do is I try to be there and be available for them as they're training, because that's what enables me to have those counseling appointments and to do the services and all of that. All of that from the ground up is built off of spending time with them and being available to build those relationships so that there is trust. I have a role, though, not only as a battalion, a chaplain, specifically assigned to my battalion, but I have a larger role within the state of supporting some other missions, and one of those is Strong Bonds. You guys have heard me talk about this before. I love doing these marriage enrichment weekends. I just did one last weekend. That's why I was a little late coming in last Sunday. But we have literally seen this turn relationships around. If you know anything at all about the military, then you can imagine that that is a lifestyle that is hard on marriages. Soldiers probably get divorced about twice as often as anybody else because they are on the move, they are away from home, and it's just a rough lifestyle. And so what we do in Strong Bonds is we teach communication, problem solving, all those basic skills to help them reconnect after deployments, prepare for deployments, and just keep life together going in the same direction as a married couple. And it's an amazing opportunity to be able to do that. It also provides us as chaplains time away from the field and away from the normal schedule to build relationships and get to know these people, these soldiers. We've had soldiers and their families visit our church because of the relationship that I built with them there. Had a great spouse come up to me last Saturday just as we were breaking for lunch and tell me that what we had done already that weekend was building the foundation for saving her marriage. And so it's just an amazing privilege to be able to be a part of that and to see those transformations take place. And sometimes that pigtails off to a counseling relationship that will go on from there so that we can really help them rebuild. Amazing thing in the day that we live in is that the technology that we have brings us closer together. And so I serve soldiers literally that live all over the state. But we can stay in touch by phone, we can video chat, we can do all of that stuff in order to support them and their families. And then you guys know a little bit about this, right? We've been through a hurricane or two together. This is actually one of the things that sold me on joining the National Guard, because the National Guard has that humanitarian mission that they are the ones, we are the ones that come in and help during and after national disasters. What I did not know, because this was not on the recruiting poster, is that when the hurricane comes, I pack my stuff and leave my house before it ever gets here. And I bring that up to say this, one thing that I would love for you to take away from today is the next time there's a storm brewing and you hear them say, Governor DeSantis, Governor whoever, is deploying, mobilizing X number of guardsmen, if you would stop for a moment and think about the fact that those soldiers are getting into vehicles and leaving their homes not knowing what that storm is going to do. We go and we do our mission and we leave our families to do that. And your prayers would be greatly appreciated during that time. You guys have seen a lot of these pictures before. We hand out food and water, do search and rescue, clean up, rescue little puppies and little old ladies. Basically, whatever needs to be done when we're in these situations, that's what we do and what's called on. But another hard thing about these missions is that when we load up and leave, we do not know when we're coming back. And so another difficulty for soldiers is you're leaving home, but you're also leaving work, because we're called weekend warriors, but there's a whole lot more to it than that. It would be so much easier if it was truly one weekend a month and 2 weeks during the summer. We are on the go a ton, and tensions, I'll just be honest, tensions are high in some areas because employers are tired of it. Soldiers are tired, employers are tired. It's a strained relationship right now. And so every time we're mobilized, that puts more stress on these families. And so if you would be praying for them and listening for those opportunities where through legislation we can do things that help protect our soldiers so they have jobs to go back to. There should never be a soldier that loses their job because they go defend our nation or help clean up after a storm. But those things do happen. I also get to do services. Now, here's the thing. When I was first becoming a chaplain, I thought this was going to be one of the biggest things that I do. I'll be honest. This is one of the least frequent things that I do. You know me as a pastor, so you know it's not that I don't want to preach God's word or sing songs about him and do all of that. But the reality is these men and women are on the run a ton. So I want you to put yourself in their shoes for a minute. You're living off of 4 or 5 hours of sleep. You're cold, you're wet, you're hungry, you are tired, and you finally got off shift and someone says, hey, you want to come to service? What do you want to do? anything else, right? Sleep, stare at a tree, like anything. And so it is hard to get them to come to service. And I've just reconciled to that. And so if you look at these pictures, that was an older picture from Camp Blanding. But this is just recently. These are two of the three services I did while I was in Croatia. And you'll see every time I was in a place where there were a few hundred soldiers around, and you might get 5 or 10 that show up because the others are working or they're sleeping or they're enjoying some free time, well earned. And so that's the other reason why my circulation is so key to the ministry that I do there. I got to stay on the go. I've got to push my introverted self to have those awkward conversations with people that I don't know until I get to know them and it's no longer awkward, so that I can have those moments of ministry, because the services are few and far between. This is another one of my favorite things, though, about what I do there, is when I have earned enough trust with a soldier that they invite me into something that impacts their family. They invite me into something that touches their life. All three of these are weddings that I did within the last 12 months. The one on the top left, we actually did on campus here. You can see some of our students. It was right at the beginning of the school year, so we invited our school students to come out and to be a part of that, to bless this couple. It was a couple I'd been working with, and so they wanted me to be a part of their wedding. And, you know, soldiers are sometimes spontaneous, so they said, hey, can we do this today? Absolutely. Come on down. We'll make it happen. And it was fun. I mean, our kids, I think they pulled together some stuff from Allison and Daryl's wedding and made a flower bouquet for her and just made it nice. And we had fun with it. But those are the moments where you know that you're touching a life, because you get invited into that part of their life. Sometimes also we have to get calls where we go to help make sure that people are safe when they are protesting, safe when things are hard or whatever may be going on. So about, I think it's been a year and a half or 2 years ago now, Priscilla started helping me with the music by doing all the music notebooks, helping pick out the music and all of that kind of stuff to take at least those couple of hours away so that I could be focused in the office. And so one day, she came and did that, and we go to lunch. And this time happened to be me and her and Melissa. We went to lunch, and we were sitting at the table when my phone rang, and it was my supervisory chaplain. And he said, hey, Jason, I need you to go to Washington, D.C. And I'm like, what? Those are not normally the calls I get. Normally the calls I get are, we need you to go see a soldier. Unfortunately, sometimes it's, we need you to go notify a family their soldier's not coming home. Can you do a funeral? Because there are chaplains spread out through the state. I am the most centrally located of all the chaplains. I am also, because of your gracious buying into my ministry, I am one of the most available chaplains in the state. I am told regularly by very senior officers within our organization to tell you thank you, because they know they can call me and I can most likely come. And so that's reflecting well on you as a church and for the kingdom, that we are a kingdom-minded church, and that is appreciated all the way up. I've had people that I didn't even know they knew who I was that have come and had that conversation with me. And so you're making a difference for Christ just in that. So I get those kinds of calls pretty regularly. I don't usually get the call that I need you on a plane to go somewhere. But there was an infantry battalion that got called up last May, when there was all kinds of stuff going on around our nation, and there were going to be some protests in D.C., the infantry was sent there, and their chaplain couldn't go. And so that's why I was needed. With less than 24 hours notice, I was on a military plane flying to D.C., and these men and women did an amazing job. But I wanted to point that out to you so that you see that side of what we do, but also to say, be very careful about how you let people inform what you think about things. One of the common things I heard during this period of time is, are you guys going to impose martial law? Even when we were in D.C., a lot of the people in D.C. were very gracious, but there were some that thought that we were there to stop protest. Absolutely not. Our guardsmen, our soldiers, our law-abiding citizens, our commanders go by the law. That's why I started out with the Constitution. That's what gives us the boundaries that we play within. We were not there to stop protests. We were there to protect people while protesting goes on, to make sure people are safe to protest. and that that right is exercised. But also, we were there to make sure people didn't break things and hurt others, because there's a line. There's a place where it stops being a protest and it starts being something else. And we were there to be in that gap, and they did an amazing job. Thankfully, as far as I know, there were no incidents. Actually, I guess it's okay to say this. The only person that was injured or had any kind of problem in that whole mission was a soldier that found glass in their pizza because someone tried to hurt them. See, those aren't the things that get put out. And I share that to say, I want you to understand what these men and women are willing to endure because they love our nation. It gets twisted by people who have agendas, and we need to understand certain people in certain places, when they're sharing a message, they're sharing that from a place and of an agenda, and we need to know when they're twisting things. These men and women, like I spent time with them. I didn't know them before. It was not my battalion that went, but I got to know them, and I saw their professionalism, and I saw their heart. And every one of us, by the time we got there and got into the mission where they were defending, our assignment was to defend the monuments. And so when they rolled into that job, every one of them knew why they were there. And over again, we heard literally from their lips, I'm following orders, but I'm also here because I love this place and I want to defend it and I want to make sure we survive this as a nation. Pray for them, please. Understand what they sacrifice and what they go through. So that's kind of in general what we do and what I do. The biggest thing to remember is where my soldiers go, I go. And so I've been asked before, like, if they deploy, will you deploy? Yes, I will. Thankfully, those are winding down. But if they go overseas, I go overseas with them. If they go somewhere else, I go there with them. If they're sleeping on the ground, I'm sleeping on the ground. I don't get privileges. I don't get chaplain privileges. Like we were at a training place one time, and I rolled up in my Humvee with all of our stuff on it, and one of the soldiers was like, so where'd you sleep last night, Chappie? I'm like, on the ground, just like you did. It was cold and wet for me, too. Oh, I thought they put you in a hotel. No! No, I'm just kidding. No, they don't do that. I wouldn't do that. I got to be where they are because that's how ministry happens. Like, if you, another thing, if you can latch on to today, there's a hook at the end for you. And part of that is, like, if we do ministry this way, we will change lives together. You don't have to put on a uniform and be called chaplain to do these kinds of things. This is what I do there is I live the life a Christian should live. Just to be honest, like that is what I do there. And that's why over and over I want to encourage us to do that. So we've been preparing for this mission for about 3 years now. Defender Europe is a large-scale military exercise. There were somewhere around 30,000 soldiers that were spread out across, 30 different training areas in different countries. I don't know if you guys can read it from there, but we had people in Germany and Slovenia. I was in Croatia. There were people in Albania, Greece, Poland, Estonia, several other places, 2,000 of us from Florida mixed in with this number, and we got to train side by side with other nations, which was a very unique and blessed experience for us to get to know the Croatians, some of the most gracious and kind people I have ever met in my life. They were just amazing to us every step of the way, and this was the view that I had every single day. It was the weirdest experience for me as a chaplain because, okay, so if you're not familiar with military culture, let me teach you a little bit. So they are taught from day one, if you're like young enlisted, you're like private, corporal, specialist, maybe even a sergeant. You don't just walk up to an officer and make a conversation. That is very highly frowned upon. You definitely don't walk up to an officer and tell them you're not happy with breakfast or that you're cold and wet and ready to go home. You just don't do that within that culture. And so I have to tear some of those walls down because when I walk in as a captain, some of them sometimes want to treat me that way. And so I have to work to like bring them down and get the young ones to stop shivering and just talk to me like a human being, you know, all that kind of stuff. But so once I build that relationship with them, though, I get to the place where they'll tell me the truth. So like the commander walks in, and how are you guys doing today? Oh, fine, sir. We're fine. Great. We're ready to train. You know, right? So when I walk in, sometimes I get the truth. How are you guys doing today? Man, it's hot. I'm like, I know. Tell me about it, right? I'm hungry. Yeah, me too. I'm tired of MREs. Gotcha. You know, like we can have those conversations. So I was expecting the normal kind of soldier complaints when we got to Croatia. A lot of times it's, you know, I'm tired. I want to go home. I'm stressed because of school. I'm stressed because of work. I'm stressed because of family. Girlfriend, boyfriend, one of each, you know, whatever. Like, they got stuff going on, and normally they're complaining about that stuff. But I get there every single day. How are you guys doing today? Did you see the sunrise? Can you believe how beautiful this place is? It is so nice to not be sweating my tail off at Camp Blanding and enjoying. It was 40 to 50 degrees most of the time that we were there, and it only rained a couple of days. And so every day, these were the views that we were having. This is another view of the camp. And so anyway, like, we were just taking in these mountains. That was literally, so that tent there was our tactical operations center, or TOC. And so those of us that are in leadership are in and out of that a lot. And this was also facing east, so the sun came up over those mountains. And it was just an amazing thing to see on a regular basis. I showed you that already. The young man, very young, 19, he's only 6 months older than Michaela. On the right there, serving Chow, is my assistant, Private Harris. And so one of the things that we do is try to find creative, non-threatening ways to just be available to soldiers. Because again, there are some cultural things there that sometimes make that difficult. And the other side is, it's like they're taught the stuff I told you about officers from the beginning. They're also taught, though, from the very beginning, you can always go to the chaplain. You can always talk to the chaplain. You don't have to get permission to approach the chaplain, and it's completely confidential. They're taught that from day one. I am the safest person they can come to. But that also means that sometimes they make themselves, or they're afraid they're making themselves a target when they come talk to me. Oh, what's he going to talk to the chaplain about? What's wrong with her? That kind of stuff. So that's why we hang out in the chow line when they're coming to get food. And I will high-five, fist bump, talk to 250, 300 soldiers all at once during an hour, hour and a half period to build that relationship so they feel safe, but also so they can be like, hey, chap, can I talk to you later? And nobody knows what just happened, because we want to build that safety for them. All right, so this is Sergeant Strong. Sergeant Strong's been here. Some of you guys have met him before. He and I got to know each other when we had our training in Mississippi a couple of years ago. And he wanted this picture taken specifically for Priscilla. So he always wants her to know that I am well taken care of and safe. So you can't really tell from this picture, but we're on top of a three-story tower there with no guardrails. This is the picture I was taking, and isn't that nice? Yeah, it's a great photo. So Strawn followed me up there and brought another guy with him so he could take a picture. He's holding on to the back of my gear, and he was like, tell Priscilla you're safe. So if you're watching, and he normally does watch our services, message received, Sergeant Strawn. She knows you were keeping me safe, so good job. One of the other unique things that I got to do was meet with their chaplain. So after we got on the ground, their people started reaching out to ours. So the medics and the doctor from their side met with our medics and doctor. Some of their leadership met with our leadership, field artillery with field artillery. And the chaplain reached out to me. And I was expecting us to meet, like, in the woods somewhere, something like that. Thankfully, it worked out really well. He did not have a military vehicle for this week. Training for the time that he was there. He was in his personal vehicle, and so he invited my assistant and I to come down to the chapel. Soldiers from there built that chapel several years ago with their hands. Look at the beauty of this inside. Now, in the 90s, unfortunately, they had a fairly brutal civil war, I believe it was, and you can see that damage all around. Like, there are really beautiful places, there are really broken places just right next to each other. If you see in the top, there are those really dark beams that are running across. Those are pieces of wood that they rescued from burnt down, blown up houses in town, and they used those as accent pieces for the chapel, as a reminder of what they went through, and that God brings beauty from difficult things. This is a really cool idea of what they did. And then you can see, so if you look straight down, you've got the cross dead center. This is a Catholic church, by the way. They are 98% Roman Catholic. So if you look down there, you see the cross on the right side of it. You can kind of see it looks like there's a poster on the wall. Those are young men from their community that died in that war. And so they did something to remember them and to remember to pray for their families. This is one of the soldiers that we got to know while we were there. He's a sergeant. The guys that were around us were mostly their communication guys, so they bonded really quickly with our communication guys. And they were just so kind and gracious to help out with the little comfort things that you would normally want to have. So one way we've gotten spoiled is we do training here. We can sneak off and go to the PX pretty much anytime you want to, as long as it doesn't interfere with training. Obviously there we couldn't do that, and we were not allowed to go into town. And so they used their network of friends and family and stuff like that to bless us with some things. Some of their guys, they're really big on meat in Croatia. My kind of people. It was awesome. Like they kill and like barbecue like right on the spot. And so, yeah, they always just had meat with them, sausage, barbecue, stuff like that. And so they found out, like, that we like meat, too. And we're like, oh, you're my people. And so it was awesome. Like, you go up to a training site, and we would talk to them, and they're like, want something to eat? And we're like, yes, we do. And it's a sausage and all of that kind of stuff. It was awesome. And I still lost some weight on that trip. So, yes, yes. Some places are not like that, and sometimes they're not allowed to. So I'm gonna just share some concluding thoughts with you to wrap up here. But before I do that, do you guys have any questions? Yes.
So I intend your position. I intend chapel for the most part.
Uh huh.
But earlier you talked about the other religions or other
within that regard. Mhm. Mhm. Okay, good question. So he's asking, if you didn't hear, since obviously I am a Christian chaplain, what about the other faith groups? What about the Muslims? What about the Jews? Like, how does that work? So the army is aggressively trying to recruit other people from other faith groups to be available, but they are much less available than we are. I think still the highest percentage of chaplains in the United States Army are not only Protestant Christians, they're actually Southern Baptist. Because of our take on things, we are very much evangelistic and go into the mission field oriented, and so our people have come into that mission field. Others treat it a little bit differently, and so that's part of the reason why you have differences in the amount that are there. But the way it works is this. So our doctrine, not church doctrine, our chaplain doctrine, is that we will perform or provide services for our soldiers. So in my battalion, I have soldiers from all kinds of different faith backgrounds. If I cannot perform a service for them, if I can't minister to them directly because they're not in line with my faith tradition, then I provide that for them by reaching out somewhere else. And so ideally, I would reach out to a Jewish chaplain to come and minister to the Jewish soldier. I would reach out to an imam to come in and minister to the Muslim soldier. They are not always available, though. And so that's where sometimes the best that I can offer is that I work with their command. So this falls into that advising part of what I do. I work with their command to help them see the need for allowing time for that soldier or even for a group of soldiers to meet and to study and to pray or whatever it may be that they need to do. And we organize that for them, even if we don't have a chaplain that can be there to oversee it, just to make sure that they're provided for. In the National Guard, we're limited more in resources, but also another reason, going back to what I shared earlier about how they're not rushing to get to services, the other reason they're not rushing to get to services is they're plugged in. The ones that are Christians are plugged into their home churches or other faith groups. They're plugged into that at home. So for a lot of them, missing it one weekend a month or for an annual training period or whatever is not a huge deal because they're going to go home and have that when they get home. In the active duty Army, those other chaplains are strategically placed so that they are accessible. And so on a post or in a garrison setting, they would have someone they could call that could come and meet with that soldier. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Not here in Florida. Right now in Florida, we have only Protestant Christian chaplains. They are working on trying to recruit that, but the limitation with the National Guard is geography. Like, we're recruiting in Florida to fill those spots, whereas active duty Army, they recruit for whatever they need and they disperse them as needed. Anything else? We cover it pretty well for you. You ready to go home and get some food? I'm not providing it, but Angela. I heard you. I'm just trying to remember it. I had to recite it every day in basic training, but you know that was a long time ago, right? Oh, yeah, that, well, so one of the things that is helpful in the military, she was asking about the Soldier's Creed. So there are actually lots of creeds, lots of different things that we memorize early on in training and recite because they help focus your mind on what it is that we're supposed to do. And that's part of the reason why I started asking John to do our mission statement with us more regularly. When you repeat those things, you keep it fresh in your mind and you can live it out. And so a part of that is also an acronym called LEADERSHIP, which is loyalty, duty, respect, selfless service, honor, integrity, personal courage. Right? Did I get it all? I think so. And the idea is that we learn those things because those are core values that we want to live out. And so that's part of what they're memorizing early on or doing push-ups when they don't say it right. But you know, I haven't had a drill sergeant around me in a while, so some of that's a little bit fuzzy, to be honest. Good question. Anything else? All right. Well, like I said, I want to share this stuff to keep you informed so you know what I'm doing, but I also always want it to be a challenge to you. If we come together and worship, I always feel like there should be some takeaway. I went to a beautiful place. I get to do some fun things. A couple of years ago, I got to ride in a helicopter for the first time, stuff like that. And so, yeah, those things are great. But I want us to also learn together what we can apply from that ministry to our ministry here. And one part of that is definitely embrace hardship. One of the things military life has really driven into me is to not always try to shield myself from the things that are hard. So every now and then, when I just want to kind of escape the world, I'll go back and watch movies that I used to really love. And so you guys know, obviously, in the rotation is Star Wars, right? Like, you knew that was coming. But the other one is Lord of the Rings. And so just over the last week, it took me a while, but just over the last week in my spare time, I watched Lord of the Rings. And one of the things that really jumped out to me this time that I had not seen before is how it's really one struggle after struggle after struggle after struggle. If you've never watched it in that context, I know it's going to take 9 hours of your life, but go back and invest the 9 hours of your life and watch how hard it is. It literally, every time an obstacle is overcome, a bigger one comes. And life is like that, and ministry is like that. One of the things I really wish I could go back and do differently would be that when I very first started mentoring and training young people that want to go in the ministry, I would have said, it's going to be hard. It's going to suck the life out of you some days, and you're going to want to quit a lot. But embrace the hardship, because Christ embraced the hardship for us to make us His. And the enemy is going to constantly attack, and we can't give up just because he attacks again. We can't give up just because it gets hard. And so embrace the hardship. Very first night I spent in Croatia, I slept on gravel because that was the best place to sleep. We were there one day. Obviously not in one day, but over one period, it rained for 36 hours. I have never been outside in the rain for 36 hours when it was 40 degrees. That was a new, horrible experience for me. Going to be honest. Chaplain wasn't happy. Like, it's usually my job to pump people up. Grumpy Chaplain has a little bit of trouble pumping people up. And so I've had to learn to embrace hardship, to find joy in suffering. When we do that, then the hard things are not obstacles we can't overcome. They're challenges that we can push through. Stay hydrated. I wrote this actually after our training 2 years ago when we were in Mississippi. It was so hot, so nasty there. The very first day of training, when we were out setting up camp, we had soldiers flown out to the hospital because they were so dehydrated on day one. You've got to, when you're out and you're working, you've got to stay hydrated. I'm not too worried about your fluid intake here. But one of the things that we associate the Holy Spirit with is water, right? We see that in the scripture. We're even told to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And so just like a soldier needs to constantly be drinking on water, I encourage you constantly be taking in the Spirit. The word picture in the Bible is that it's an act of surrender. It's not a filling in the sense of I just pray a prayer and God pours out the Spirit on me. When Paul says be filled with the Spirit instead of being drunk on wine, the comparison he's making is that you constantly, and you and I constantly take in the Spirit, we constantly surrender to the Spirit and give Him over control. And that's how we stay hydrated in this walk. Stay clean. The other thing we learned on that mission, because we were out in a dry, dirty, nasty place, is that if you don't clean your body often, you get rashes, and it will come back to bite you. And so we had to teach some young soldiers, you got to get out the baby wipes, you got to get some water, you got to clean your body, you got to change your uniform, or it's going to haunt you later. In the same way, the Bible says, who can ascend to His holy hill? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. That's from the Psalms. We need to stay clear and clean before God. We need to be emptying out the sin and the stuff that burdens us. Paul talked about taking off all the sin that entangles and holds us back so that we can be clean before Him and useful for Him. Mission first. That's one of those sayings from the Army. You're going to see it everywhere. Like the Army loves slogans, right? And so it's funny. You'll walk into like work areas sometimes, and it's like, mission first, safety always. I don't know. It's just, I guess it works. But one of the things that is drilled into us, again, from the very beginning, is you can't quit on a mission because it's hard. You can't quit on a mission because you ran out of something. You can't quit on a mission because you're sick or because you're injured. Someone else's life may be lost if you don't complete your mission. And so there is this never fail mentality in the military, and I really feel like we need to adopt that in ministry. People drop out of church. People drop out of ministry when it gets hard. We lose focus because we try to do too many things and because we forget what the real mission is. Jesus gave us the mission. He said, all authority was given to me on heaven and earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded. But don't worry, paraphrasing now, don't worry, I will be with you even to the very end of the age. Don't lose sight of the mission. We are not here to do church services. We are not here to have a school. We are not here to have a counseling ministry or a youth ministry. We are not here for a kids ministry. We are here to make disciples and to make Christ known. That is the mission. We do that through the kids ministry, the counseling ministry, the youth ministry, the school, and all those things, and our worship services. Those are the means by which we do the ministry, but always put the mission first. Don't fail at the mission. Don't quit the mission. Don't get sidetracked from the mission. Protect your battle buddy. That's what Sergeant Strong was doing. He made it a joke, but I know at the same time he genuinely wanted to make sure the chaplain wasn't going to fall off the tower. Because let's be honest, chaplain's not only grumpy, but chaplain's clumsy sometimes, and it would have been really bad for the whole mission if the chaplain dies falling off the communications tower. So Sergeant Strong was making sure I was safe whether I wanted him to or not. I have felt more protected and taken care of in that environment than I have anywhere else in my life. Because I literally know that I am with people that have promised to lay down their life for mine. And I have promised to lay mine down for theirs. One of the saddest things in military or ministry is when someone gets taken out by friendly fire, but it happens far too often here. We need to watch out for each other and care for each other and put up with each other and endure each other's personalities and quirks and difficulties because the mission comes first. And because when Christ laid down His life, He made us a family, and a part of that family is that we take care of each other, and that should be paramount in everything that we do. So protect your battle buddy. And so I bring this back to you. I told you this was my mission verse for what I do in the National Guard, but I encourage you to make it yours for what you do in life, that you would see yourself as Christ, you would see yourself as Jesus' ambassador, that God would make an appeal through you at work and at home and at school and wherever it is that you go to implore people on Christ's behalf to be reconciled to God. If I've said this once, I've said it 100 times, there is nothing special about me. Not a thing. There is nothing that makes me great and enables me to do what I do. It is the Spirit's calling. It is Christ's blood. It is the grace of God that saw through what I was to what I can be. And that is why I am what I am and I do what I do. And I promise you, it is the same for you. God has a calling for you no matter how old you are or where you are in life. He has a ministry that you can be a part of. He set you apart to be an ambassador where you are, to reach those that you were with. Keep doing that. I'm not saying you're not. Keep doing it. Learn to do it better, more effectively, with more passion, and for His honor and glory. And we will together see God change the lives of those that we get to be ambassadors to. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the opportunities that you have placed before us, for the ministry that you have called us to at home and at work and at school and National Guard, here. Speak through us, God. Help us to have boldness and love, strength and perseverance, that we would make you known. God, help us to see more people respond to that. Help us to see more people changed by that. Help us to see life transformed as you give life through us to the people that we represent you to, that we implore on your behalf to be reconciled to you and through you to the life that you have called us to. God, for ones that are struggling this morning because of health-related issues, for ones that are struggling this morning because Father's Day is hard for them, for those that are struggling this morning because they don't know how something's going to be resolved tomorrow, whatever it may be, God, I pray that you would make yourself real and known in this moment, in this time, for those that need you the most, that we would rest in you, and that we would build our lives on your word and on your love and on your Son. Moving us now, Father, in a way that only you can, and draw us to your side for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I will be down here if you would like to come down and pray. If you would like to know more about military ministry or just using your gifts and abilities for God, or if there's something that I can pray for you and your family, I would love to be able to do that. If you'd like to do that in a more private way, you can just slip towards the back and one of our leaders will meet you back there and encourage you. Would you please stand as we sing? Jesus, the name above every other name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us today for worship. God bless you, fathers. Have a great day. Know that you are making a difference. I saw a post from a friend at another church that I thought was appropriate for today. It talked about how, unfortunately, culturally right now, because there are some broken and hurting people, and some of that comes from absent or just bad fathers. The world sometimes turns that to all fathers and turns fatherhood into a negative thing. But fatherhood, just like motherhood, is a blessed thing. Guys, uphold the calling that God has given you. He entrusted you with baby humans to raise. He entrusted you with a wife to protect and honor and care for. Live up to that. Let the world see that and recognize that in that they see God. God presented him as a father, and that is a huge calling for us then to honor him so that the world sees the right image of him as a father. And God bless you guys. Know that you are making a difference in this world, and I look forward to what God has for us in the next, I don't know what, John, 5, 10, 15, 20 years together, something like that, with a whole bunch more dad jokes along the way.
Maybe 50.
There you go.
All right, in a minute, Jordan's going to pray. No, I would do it to you again. Maybe.
Yeah,
that's how I pick up my slack. Here, let's see here. Don't forget the youth car wash this Saturday from 9 to 12 and also the work day here at the church so we can get some more things done. Speaking of work that's been done at the church, did anybody also notice? My daughter pointed this out just a minute ago, and I had not noticed that. The ceiling fans are gone. How many had noticed that? I had not noticed that. And so anyway, for those of you that hated those when they were spinning and blowing cold air down on you, it's a blessing. And those of you that are hot, then it's not a blessing. But anyway, they're gone for now. I guess they're gone, right?
Yeah, they're gone.
They're gone. Tell them bye. All right. Well, thank you all for being here. I hope you guys have a great Father's Day. Get-togethers maybe, or going out to eat or something like that, or just being around them or give them a call, and so that would be great. And, you know, I appreciate our founding fathers and the leaders of our military being wise enough to have chaplains to be able to help our soldiers and our military forces during times of war and non-war so that they can get direction and have that spiritual side so that they can be the warriors and represent our country and do what needs to be done in their job. So I'm glad of that and glad that we were able to get more information on that today. So let's pray, and we'll get on our way so we can get some meeting done. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Lord, thank you that we have a day set aside for fathers, Lord, where we recognize them. You would bless this day, bless each of those that are here, and each of the fathers. Lord, help us to do our job. Lord, I pray that you just bless now and give us a great day until we come back again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You're dismissed. Thanks a lot for being here.